All right, perfect. So welcome to the Board of Selectmen meeting for Tuesday, November 17th, 2020. So just moving quickly into the agenda, actually for housekeeping, Mr. Brian Dick will not be able to attend. He had a previous obligation for this evening. So let's jump into schedule items. We have 6:15, Verizon Cable TV contract renewal, and we have with us Mr. August to review.
Okay. Do you want me to start?
Yeah, please, Mr. August. Just at a high level, kind of why we're here, and then get into the details, and we'll go from there.
Okay. First, I want to thank the manager, Richard Montevori, and his team that he has had present at all stages of this, Sam and Brian Dorrington, especially Richard has just been available at every single twist and turn of the verbiage and the back and forth. So it's been a very engaged and strong team, including preparation of a lot of budget backup and demonstration of financial need to help us make our case for what turned out to be a very successful negotiation. Right, at a high level, the two main buckets of financial support in a cable renewal license are the annual franchise fee, which in Massachusetts goes into the local PEG access and related facilities like community channels, studios, equipment, facilities, and related technology. So that's the annual. And then the Cable Act permits a negotiation of a capital grant above and beyond the annual franchise fee. Let me start with the capital grant. It's an example of why I feel so good about what we've negotiated so far. It's about 50, the Verizon commitment is about 50% more than the Comcast commitment. The Comcast commitment is 20,000 a year in capital. It's actually expressed as a percentage of revenues, but it was paying out about 20,000 a year. As Comcast is losing subscribers, that's slipping down a little bit each year. The Verizon commitment is 150,000 capital. This is separate from the annual. The annual is actually much bigger. But I'm starting with the capital because it's comparatively a lot stronger than Comcast's. The Verizon commitment is 150,000 for a 5-year license. So that's 30,000 a year in capital. It averages two. And that's despite the fact that Comcast has about 1,000 more subscribers, or 800 to 1,000. It varies. Comcast has about 56% of the subscribers. So Verizon, with a smaller subscriber base, is paying 50% more, 30,000 compared to the 20,000 per year in the equipment grants for the local studio and the PEG access. In terms of while we could do better from Verizon on the capital, on the annual, they insist on just being identical to Comcast. So Comcast is now at 3.5% of gross a year, 3.5% of gross revenues. That's what Comcast pays. And Verizon agreed to match it. Although we did get language from Verizon saying that if we get Comcast to go up from their 3.5% at any time during this license period, at any time during Verizon's license period, Verizon will match it. And so you should have an opportunity to crank that up when you get into the next Comcast renewal. So in the two big financial categories, the annual franchise fee and the capital, everyone should feel confident that this is a good, solid package. The one thing that's new, separate from the money, that's very exciting, and it's one of the things, if I may mention, Selectwoman Jane Wellman advocated for when I came down, you know, to the public hearing that was held to give the public had an, you know, a public proceeding where we left the record open, and there was a great turnout there. There was a lot of support, and Selectwoman Wellman mentioned that we should try to get an additional PEG access channel, as and express support for getting a high definition PEG access channel, which Comcast does not provide in Tewksbury, but Verizon agreed to provide it. So whereas Comcast will be at the three PEG access channels, Verizon has agreed to continue three standard digital PEG access channels, plus if the town requests it, Verizon must provide a fourth high definition PEG access channel. That's very exciting to the access community. Comcast, it's not in the Comcast license. They never did a single PEG HD channel until late 2018, but now they're starting to. So when the Comcast renewal comes up, you should try to get them to match the Verizon HD PEG access channel. And overall, the license is just one of those very comprehensive licenses. And I have to also, in addition to thanking Richard and his team, we should thank Verizon because, like, they have a government relations team. They're, like, dealing with many states and, like, over 100 licenses, but they were so very responsive. And we have very comprehensive language, you know, not only the three PEG channels plus the new HD channel and the good capital package, but as, you know, as we always get and is supposed to be required, it's a non-exclusive license in every sense of the word, so there can always be competition from other providers and new providers. The license incorporates very comprehensive customer service standards. We have a whole exhibit with adoption of telephone response standards, timetables for installations, and a whole slew, very comprehensive, that they agreed to. They continue to provide complimentary service to the public schools. That was another point that Selectwoman Wellman emphasized in her email to Richard, also to, you know, remind us of some of the things that she drew attention to. This continuation of the same full service area you have now, very comprehensive insurance requirements and indemnification language and performance bond. You know, one of the things that is particularly great, I think, is the level playing field clause. All the cable operators insist on level playing field language, providing that if someone else is authorized by the town, you know, that they have to be at the same, at least as good a level, at least as strong a level as Verizon. And one of the companies makes that level playing field language applicable to any competitors that use the right of way. But in terms of the level playing field and its applicability to the money, the annual payments and the capital, Verizon agreed to compromise language that we would only have to make level playing field adjustments with respect to providers that pay less if those providers are licensed cable companies. We wouldn't have to make adjustments for non-cable competition, which unfortunately is the trend that the cable companies are seeking to get into these licenses. So we did great on the level playing field language. I keep going back to Jane Wellman's memo to Richard, because we've did follow that for, because it had some like extras to look for. And I was pleasantly surprised, because I didn't think, you know, Comcast never agrees to it. But one of the things that was asked for, I mean, it's sort of a mixed bag because, but it's very good. was to try to get an electronic programming guide that would include PEG access listings. So Verizon said they have never agreed to that, but they have, but what they said that they would give us most favored nation language. So we have a clause, section 5.8, that says if they provide that to any other town in Massachusetts, then they will provide it to us. And the same thing on the other item like that, that was asked for in that list and commentary comments from at the public hearing, was to have a PEG access on demand service. And Verizon took the same position. They said, although we haven't done it, we will agree to give you, you know, a level, a most favored nation clause. So if they do that anywhere else, you know, they have to roll it in here upon town request. So the license is comprehensive. It has like the, you know, all the types of enforcement, insurance, indemnification, customer service standards, non-exclusivity that we look for. And then in sort of the sort of hot ticket items of annual funding, capital payments, and good level playing field clause language, which are the important, you know, most negotiated, toughest areas. I think we're doing really, really well. So that's sort of my overview. I think we're in good shape.
Okay, perfect. Thank you, Mr. August. So at this point, let's open up to the board for questions. How about Ms. Wellman?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. August. I appreciate you being here tonight and all the work that you've done. I know what goes into these negotiations, so I understand how long it takes. And I read through the agreement, draft agreement that was in our packet, and it had a number of edits in it. And you could see where you're going back and forth with Verizon Council or their representative. And so I can see that they're very strong on a few points, and I appreciate you pushing them in places. It was nice to see that. Can you just give us I know you said we're getting $150,000 in the capital payment side. Are those payments front-loaded? Are they structured?
They are. I forgot to mention that. They have to pay the 150. Great question. They have to pay the 150,000 in the first 3 years, 50,000 a year.
Yeah, I think that's
unfortunately the reason for that. I mean, it's always good to ask for that, but one thing that made it painfully necessary here and in every Verizon community is although Verizon has never exercised this option, they, you know, swear on the Bible that they will never sign a license more than 5 years. So the Verizon licenses are 5 years. And then after 3 years, they have an option to reduce the license to 3 years to terminate at the end of that notice period. Yeah. So because even though they've never exercised that, so it's just we have every reason to believe it's a solid 5-year license. But because of that possibility, they did agree to upfront the capital into the first 3 years.
Well, yeah, I think it's the future of cable television services is, you know, I think it's not going anywhere. But I also know that more folks are cutting the cord, and so that's cutting their subscribers. I don't know what our subscribers have done in the last few years. It was interesting to hear that you mentioned that our Comcast has more subscribers than Verizon. So, and that was something I was aware of. In Winchester, their cable contract was published not too long ago, and their capital is a fair amount more. It's like in the $200,000 range. And I don't know if that's a subscriber-based thing. I don't know how many subscribers Verizon has in Winchester. But that was something I was looking at. It was in the paper, I don't know, sometime in the fall, maybe September.
Right. It's often relative to Comcast. They have like a formula, because in Winchester, the Comcast license had more capital. So they do agree to pay a premium above Comcast, but only to a certain limit. So once they were at 50% more than Comcast, they drew the line, which they are here in Tewksbury.
All right, that's good to understand how that how that funding is sort of scheduled and planned out. Okay. I read through everything. I really appreciate you pushing on the HD channel as well. It wasn't in the appendix that lists the channels, and I don't know if that's because we haven't invoked that yet, and that's why it's not in the appendix.
It has not been, and it cannot be invoked until the effective date.
So May something.
Yeah. May 21.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Well, again, thank you so much. Great job, you and the team. And I appreciate all of the work that you've done. I think it's good to bring this one home. Thank you.
Thank you. Good.
How about Ms. Stronach?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So this is really Ms. Wellman's wheelhouse. She has been with this since the very beginning. She stole what the one question that I had, she's already asked. And I too want to just say, it's great to see Verizon stepping up to the plate. I'm glad to hear from that you have pushed them to the maximum capacity. So we certainly appreciate that. And I also appreciate the gratitude that you extended to the team to help get this across the finish line. And I'm really excited to hear that we're moving forward on this.
Good. I should also emphasize in terms of gratitude, Brian Dorrington wrote extremely detailed, I forget if it was like 5 pages of nugget after nugget, documenting and proving the equipment that would need itemizing would be needed over a 5-year license term with like real good numbers and backup. And, you know, when you send that over to Verizon, it just helps so much. So that was invaluable.
Well, I'm not surprised to hear about that invaluable contribution by Brian and his team. They are incredibly capable, and we are very blessed to have an outstanding staff across the town. So thank you for your work on this. Thank you for bringing it forward. And I have get nervous with shrinking cable, so I'm excited to have this in place. Thank you. That's all,
right,
Mr. Chairman.
Procedurally, we do have to hold a public hearing before adoption.
Okay.
So this is, I see this as informational update. Yep. And then based on how it goes tonight, you know, I'll talk to Richard about that schedule for adoption. It probably makes sense to do it sooner rather than later, because things are changing so fast in cable, you know, it's good to lock things up too.
Good call. How about Mr. Mike Kratman?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. August, I was looking through this, and I know year after year we go through this budget, and we look at, you know, we look at the new license agreements. And when we take fees from Comcast and Verizon, they turn around and write them off to the subscribers, which in part raises their cable fees. And we have been very careful when we're looking for that, not to ask for too much. I think our percentage of what we're looking for.
Right.
But I'm curious, if other communities ask for more, does that affect just their community, or does it affect the surrounding communities? So say if Wilmington's asking for a higher fee,
right,
for their cable costs, then we
just the community, fee. Just the community.
So it would just, I just want to clarify. So the fact that we're asking for lower fees will lower the actual fees for.
The 3.5% a year, it's level funding. It will have no impact because, I take that back. You have to look at it where you are relative to their current level. So it's close to level fund. When it's level funding, it just continues as is. Yeah. The increment from the capital is pretty minuscule, because you amortize that over all the But you're exactly right. It's not, you have to balance those policy issues, the rate impact, how it affects rate structure, as well as, you know, getting the money and find the right balance for your town. That's exactly right. And it's done on a town by town, for this part of the cost structure, it's done on a town by town basis by the companies.
So there are a number of towns around us that ask for a lot more.
That some towns go up to 5% a year. That's the maximum permitted. And that would, their rates would be 1.5% more than yours, because yours are at 3.5% franchise fee.
And the cable rates through the roof already. I see them going up.
Right. But even when you have level funding on the PEG fees are a minuscule percentage of the total rate structure, because even when you level fund your studio, have like no increases, like some towns just level fund, within 10 years, the company's going to end up doubling its rates. So it had, and they attribute it to, you know, the ESPN raising its costs like X million dollars every couple of years, and then other premium services and, you know, their financial debt levels and other factors. If you're looking at rising rates, which everyone is, like, you know, the PEG access component of it is really the low man on the totem pole. It's the other big ticket items that are driving up the rates.
I just don't want the general public to get the wrong perception that though we are fighting to get the best equipment, the best channels, the best things that we can get for the town, that is not attributing to their cable.
No, it's not. No, because this is a moderate package at 3.5, and it's similar to where you are now in that, in the main issue, the annual payment. So this should not be a cost driver.
Okay. That's all. I just want to clarify that and make sure we're right on the same page.
Right. It will be a very small, they might, if they implement it, a small adjustment on the capital pass-through, but it'll be pennies per subscriber, really.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Crabby. So, Mr. August, I'll be last but not least here. Just super quick, because I almost say sometimes you have to be a lawyer to read the document that we get. I know you've been doing this for many years across many municipalities. So what's one or two things for this particular contract, this renewal, that kind of stick out for the residents, that kind of bring it down to layman's terms, if you would?
Right. What, to just give an overview in real simple layman's terms?
Yeah, just one or two or three wins within this contract that you're satisfied.
Yep. Right. Well, I think the, you know, the wins are that just securing cable service in this day and age is a win, because so many of the companies, as was alluded to earlier, are just in the mindset of, you know, switching over to the wireless model or the internet TV model. So we have guaranteed commitment to having the cable system and its service. And, you know, we are adding an HD PEG channel. And in Tewksbury, like so many towns, the community channels, like, you know, they're growing. They're coming out of a startup mode, and now they're recognized as being, you know, a vibrant part of the community scene. And this license recognizes that by giving them an additional channel and by giving them a solid footing to continue to serve your community. And then it's just a very comprehensive license that protects the subscribers and the town government itself by having reporting requirements and comprehensive customer service standards. So it's just an overall solid license providing for a lot of service and support.
Okay, perfect. All right, Mr. August. So, Mr. Montori, that's really all I had. I guess any other questions from the board? Okay, seeing none. So, Mr. Montori, what we thought is we'd digest this and what, potentially regroup at a later date, hopefully sooner than later, to kind of make the official, you know, to vote one way or another. Is that correct?
Yeah, I think that's fine, Mr. Chairman.
Okay.
Thanks, folks.
Very good.
Have a great
Thank
night.
Thank you, Mr. August, per usual.
Stay safe out there, everybody. Okay,
Thanks
bye.
Hi, everyone.
Hi, Anna.
Hey, Anna.
Hi.
All right, so what we're going to do is we're going to transition now. This is kind of a special evening. We're going to have the select board as well as the planning board join. I'm trying to look here, and I still think we have some more folks. And as a matter of fact, we're scheduled for 6:45, so we have a few minutes. So if you want to take a three-minute break, be my guest. Hey, Mr. Eric Ryder. We're going to get started here in a few minutes. That's all.
No problem.
Mr. Steve Johnson, we'll get started here in a few minutes. Mr. Jay Delaney, thanks for jumping on. We'll get started here in 30 seconds.
Can you hear me?
I can
Perfect,
hear you,
Mr. Jay Delaney. Perfect.
Okay.
Yep.
Thank
hey,
you.
How are you?
I go through this all the time.
You're fine. We'll just give it another 30 seconds for Mr. Fowler, and then I think we'll be good. All right, well, how about this? Why don't we get started? On this section of the meeting? So first and foremost, I guess just super quick here. So I guess this is, I'm going to call it a bit of a special evening here. So this is a joint meeting between the select board and the planning board. And there will be no, this isn't a public hearing, so there'll be no public comments tonight. So the bottom line for this meeting is simple, we have two topics. I'm going to talk about the Pleasant Street and Main Street intersection, and then we're going to touch upon sidewalks. So for both of these topics here, they're kind of near and dear to both of our respective boards. So we said, hey, let's have a joint meeting. Let's have some collective feedback. I always say we're smarter together than we are apart. And this way, no one's working in a vacuum. So what we'll do, just to kind of lay, you know, just for housekeeping, is we'll review the presentation. We'll start with the Pleasant Street intersection. We'll have the folks review the presentation. After the presentation, what we'll do is we'll open it up for dialogue. I would ask all of the board members to maybe hit one or two points. Let's be respectful for time. And last but not least, I drew a batting order out of a hat. So what I'll do is I'll call upon each board member accordingly. And then we'll jump in. That sound like a plan?
Sounds great.
It's okay with me.
All right, very good. All right, very good. Okay, who do we have on? Who do we have on to represent or actually to review the Pleasant Street intersection plan? And again, just for the residents, this is draft two, I guess, just a little more color here. So when the fire station was built and the elementary school is being built, both the planning board and the select board said, wait a minute, we have a big opportunity here for our center downtown. You know, what are we going to do? Are we going to look at that? How are we going to make it bigger, better, faster? Because look at, you know, our town is growing. And oh, by the way, we have a project way up on East Street and Daskam Road that also will contribute to it. So the bottom line is, we said, let's take a hard look at this intersection and what can we do? Because I don't want to like make this dramatic, but I do believe for the next 50 to 100 years, what we agree on, what we do in this town center is going to have a significant, I mean, significant impact to alleviate traffic, because we all know how it's structured today. So again, let's be positive. And this is a real, real big decision for our town. Again, the kind of hence the point of let's get together and talk through the pros and cons and see if this is right or if we go to the drawing board again. So, all right, now I'll pause and turn it over to the folks that will present. Is it Lance?
Yes. Richard, did you want to say a couple of things, or do you want me to just dive right in?
The only thing I'll say, Lance, is so we have Lance Hill and Amy Archer on from PAR, who was hired by the town to undertake the design of the Pleasant Main intersection. The chair was mentioned, we've been through a couple of concepts. Tonight is to go through the second version, and hopefully at some point we can end up at a consensus to move forward with and send in a plan to MassDOT so we can start lining up possible funding in the future and permitting. This is, again, just a night to get some feedback on the latest plan. Lance will present, and Amy will present and answer any questions that we have.
Okay. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. For the members of the board and the planning board here, my name is Lance Hill. I'm with PAR Corporation. I'm a managing engineer in our Foxborough office. As Richard had said, we were hired by the town to take a look at the Pleasant and Main Street intersection. We've been at this for a bit here, and we've prepared several iterations. And tonight we're going to present kind of where we are at this point. I'm going to step out of the way here, and I'm going to let the smarter people here to give the presentation. So Amy's going to jump in and walk you right through it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Lance. Amy Archer with PAR Corporation. I've been working with Lance and the town on this. So I'm going to go ahead and share my screen here. It looks like I have that capability. So let's bring up the PDF. And if someone could at least give me a head nod once you can see that, that'd be great. Thanks.
Perfect.
All right. So we did do some initial concepts a couple months back now, and we had a conversation with the planning board, and we've had a few conversations with the town. And the direction thus far is that we think the best way to go with this is to maintain signalization. And we want to make sure that we're doing that in a way that allows for some future growth, handles the existing conditions to the extent possible, is balancing movements where demand exists. And then for anyone that may not have been involved in the last conversation, part of the intent is to get rid of the segment of East Street that currently extends along its primary path and connects into Main Street just west of the intersection and east of where the new fire station is going. So right now, that leg of East Street kind of connects into Main Street at its own intersection at a very skewed angle, provides some uncertainty to drivers about where the right-of-way is. And so we're trying to mitigate that condition as well as I mentioned, accommodate all of the volumes and movements, as well as hopefully project some additional improvements for pedestrians as need may be at the intersection itself. So a couple of things that we looked at were the count data that we received for the intersection. We've projected that out. You typically want to make sure that our roadway designs are good for at least a 20-year period. So we looked at some census data. We did an inflation from current volumes out to a 2040 design year. And we said, all right, what is the intersection if we don't change any of the configuration? If we keep the layout of this area exactly as it is, how would that function? And looking at those volumes, where are the greatest demands, including the build out of the school along Pleasant Street, as well as the movement of the fire station over to the leg of Main Street here. So the primary movements that were underserved were coming left off of Pleasant. So if you're coming up Pleasant from near the school and you want to turn left onto Main Street, there's not currently a dedicated lane to do that, and that does have a high volume. The left from Main Street onto East Street, so it does have its own left turn lane today, but it still has a very high volume. And then coming from East Street, making a right onto Main. So currently that has its own leg, but if we want to get rid of that leg and bring it into the intersection, this approach of East Street today is only one lane. So we went through a couple of iterations and said, let's see where the highest demand is and how we can handle it. So first we added a left from Pleasant onto Main. We ran that as a scenario. And then we kept the left from Pleasant onto Main, and we added in addition a right channelized lane from East onto Main. So this this lane here from East Street onto Main Street would function under yield control. So even if the signal technically had a red for East Street, those people could complete their movement. You can kind of see the geometry here allows for that to happen a little bit smoother. Within the count data, we also observed that was a high volume of trucks making that movement. So we're trying to make sure that the turning movements for different design vehicles are accommodated in addition to just timing. So kind of laying out those things, looking at the no build condition, which is just a projection of 2040 with no change in layout, an addition of a left turn lane from Pleasant on the Main, and then an additional lane add from East onto Main. Those were the things that we considered. So I'm going to zoom in now on this table here, and hopefully with that brief understanding, we can go through this table a little bit. So what this is showing is if you were approaching from the various legs of the intersection, how much delay would you experience as a driver? So you start to approach the signal, how long are you gonna have to sit there before you can complete the movement? Please keep in mind, as we were doing this, we did it north oriented. So Main Street is your east and west leg. East Street is the north leg, and Pleasant Street is the south leg. And then on the rightmost column, we have the intersection as a whole. So if you don't change the configuration of the intersection at all, and you project out to year 2040, the average person at that intersection is sitting for over 75 seconds of delay. If we add the left turn lane from Pleasant Street onto Main Street, that comes down 20 seconds, and your average person is sitting for under a minute. And then if we add in addition the channelized right turn from East Street onto Main Street, so essentially replicating the movement that happens with that leg today that we're trying to remove, add that right turn from East Street onto Main, that brings you down almost another 15 seconds. So now you're down to the average person waiting at that intersection for just over 40 seconds. And then I do have one more line here. So this is a little conceptual, so I'll just explain what it is. But the last thing that the town asked us to take a look at was, what if we do better accommodation of pedestrians at the intersection? There's some thought that as the town continues to grow, the fire station's placed just to the west, the school is to the south. Are we going to get increased pedestrian movements at this intersection, and how are we going to make sure that they're accommodated? So there are crosswalks across all four legs of the intersection. And there are two different ways that you can handle pedestrians. One is an exclusive pedestrian phase, which I imagine everybody's encountered, where all vehicles are stopped on a red light and the pedestrians move in each direction. And the other way to handle them is with what's called a leading pedestrian interval. So we did analyze both. I did not put the exclusive pedestrian in this table because it basically negated all of the benefit we were trying to attain with the lane additions. It would take the delay back up to over 63 seconds per person, and various approaches would have what's considered a failing level of service. So we did not show that here in the potential recommendations of alternatives, but the other option to put a leading pedestrian interval, which essentially when a pedestrian triggers the signal, instead of getting a full phase, which is typically close to 20 to 25 seconds, instead of getting that full period, they get a lead. They get 4 to 5 seconds where they start to enter the intersection before the vehicles get their green. And it gives the pedestrians a chance to get into the intersection, which makes them more visible. So if people are starting to make a movement, they have clear visibility of the pedestrian, their presence, where they're going to, and they can accommodate them accordingly. So if we add a leading pedestrian interval and keep the other two lanes, so we're adding the left from Pleasant to Main, we're adding the right from East to Main, and then we put the leading pedestrian interval in addition to that, it adds about 6 seconds of delay back, which is not bad. So this is essentially where we got to with our recommendation. We would recommend that you add a left turn from Pleasant, you add a channelized yield controlled right turn from East, and you consider the implementation of a leading pedestrian interval. So I will zoom back out to the visual, kind of give a sense. And then one last thing I'll touch on for anyone that hasn't seen any of the other iterations or the previous presentation, in removing that existing leg of East Street that extends westward and connects into Main, we would also realign the driveways along the side of the roadway. So some of them are as simple as extending them out to the new curb line of Main Street, and others would be a consolidation in merging where they go. Right now, some of them come in very close to the stop line on East Street, and the backup or the queue from East Street blocks that access point. So we're trying to eliminate some of that blocking of paths. We don't want people coming out of these homes to block trucks trying to come down East Street and turn onto Main, and we don't want a queue on East Street to block people's access to their residential properties. So we were looking at some ways to start to consolidate those. So I'll put that out there. If people want to comment on improvement in delay, the recommendation of lane configuration and where we think movement should be added, or how to handle some of these properties along the edge of the road, I think those are all valid points of input that we would appreciate.
Excuse me, Mr. Chairman.
Please, go ahead.
Thank you. Amy, thank you very much. I was trying to take some notes as you were speaking. Can you please give me the final recommendation? You gave a lot of scenarios, but the final recommendation is adding the left-hand turn. And what was the other piece of that?
So it's what's shown here. There's a left from Pleasant onto Main. We recommend that that be added. And then we also recommend that a yield-controlled channelized right be added from East Street onto Main.
Okay, thank you. Sorry, Mr. Chairman.
That's fine. We're almost at that time anyways for questions, so it was perfect. Anything else, Amy, on your side?
I think just one other thing I'll point out here. The long line, double dash, long line, those are the right-of-way lines. So we did also try to be mindful of where right-of-way could be accommodated and where limitations were. The common over here in the southwest portion of the intersection, based on the orientation of the drawing, this building in the southeast, likely a historic property. So we tried to stay away from that. We tried to not clip the corner on the gas station property, just to point out a couple things there within the constraints that we were trying to adhere to.
Okay. All right, fair enough. Let's do this, then. Let's open it up to the board. Like I said, let's maybe each board member have one or two talking points. Let's be respectful of time. And like I said, I did draw the batten order up. So why don't we start with, how about Mr. Mark Kratman?
Why is it every time it's a highway, you start with me?
I did pick it up. I'm telling you, I picked it out of a hat. I'm telling you.
All right. No, Amy, thank you very much for the presentation. I looked at, you gave a lot of scenarios. I understood a lot of this. I've reviewed a number of highway plans. But when you're giving timings and you're talking about how we're reducing and we're getting to certain things, and then you say it's not bad. Well, the residents, a typical intersection, what is the timing when we're doing this? And if we do your recommendations and we get to peak capacity or whatever we can do out there, the peak of changes to these things, how does this relate to other intersections? And what do your improvements do to the way it's existing and the way it's proposed? How much time? Is there time savings? And did we take the peak hours into consideration? Because that's really what we're talking about. We're talking about the evening commute, and we're talking about the school morning commute. Those are the peak hours that we'd be dealing with. So how would those relate to residents trying to get through these intersections?
Yes, so we did take into consideration. We looked at count data from the AM peak, the PM peak, and the school release peak. So generally we count 2 hours during each of those periods, a 7 to 9 in the morning, a 2 to 4 in the afternoon for the school, and then a 4 to 6 in the evening for the PM commuter. What we're looking at here was we looked at those three timeframes. We found the one that had the maximum extent of vehicles approaching the intersection, which is your morning peak. Generally that is common to happen near a school. You end up with an overlap of your school arrival and your morning commuter peak. So that was the hour that we were analyzing. And I will point out that the no build scenario, I'm going to zoom back into the chart here. The no build that we assessed here does take into consideration not only that 20-year background growth, but also the projected volumes of the school reconstruction. So we are trying to make sure that we're not disregarding any known development in the area. We looked at the shift in traffic for the fire station movement, and we looked at the projections of the school reconstruction. So the numbers all the way on the right column, I think these are the primary ones to look at. If you look at the no build scenario, that means that you move the fire station, which you're doing, you reconstruct the school, which you're doing, and you don't do anything else to this intersection. You leave the configuration of it the way it is today. Your average person is sitting in over 75 seconds of delay. That's not amazing. That's a level of service E. You're approaching a level of service F. Generally, with traffic, if you were going to look at it as a level of service, you don't necessarily want to be an A or B. That's like in the middle of the night when there's almost nobody on the road. That hardly exists, but you want to be pretty comfortably in a CD range. The E is getting uncomfortable when people feel the delay, and an F is considered failing. So your no-build scenario, you certainly don't want to do nothing here. You want to try to improve the movements, address where the demand is, and try to lower that delay. So taking from that no-build to the 76.2, we would get it down to either a 42.7 second delay if you don't put in the leading pedestrian interval, or 48.4 seconds of delay if you do. So that's taking you into that high level D range of level of service. So this is a substantial improvement. I think this would be a notable change to the residents.
Okay, Amy, that's great. I'm looking at that, but I'm always looking to try to get to, I know nobody's in A and B. I'd love to be close to B because this, right now, we're in F at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. So I know it doesn't say it, but anybody who drives this road knows what this road is and how bad it is and how much traffic and how much truck traffic and delays and things that happen. Every resident drives up and down this road knows how congested it gets, and that's the whole reason we're here. Has there been any looking, I know we talked about if we do that intersection and we do a turning lane, but we do have some land out there, which is, you know, we have some right-of-way out there, which if you look at the, where all this green area is on both sides of this location, would additional turning lanes, like a widening, where on sections of it, like say where the town common is and where you're going over to where the fire station is, instead of extending the driveways out, would it be any benefit if we added like some moving lanes to get some of the traffic? So if cars are coming up Main Street and turning right onto Pleasant Street, and if they had a designated lane to do that, or if there was cars coming up Main Street taking a, you know, left to go toward East Street, if they had it designated and we had two lanes continuously going, has that all been taken into consideration? Have we looked at all those scenarios? Like if we added an extra lane, widened it and added an extra lane out there?
Yep. So the one movement that still has a high demand, even in this configuration, is that left turn from Main up onto East Street. We did consider adding a second lane there if you widened out Main Street here. It can be accommodated within the right-of-way on Main Street. It does get difficult coming up east without clipping the gas station parcel. And this is quite a curve. So we also looked at some of the turning movements of a truck. And if you did a double turn lane, a truck would almost completely use up that space anyway. It's hard to keep them just in one lane. So we tried to make this a little bit wider lane just for one vehicle. And you have such a short stretch between here and the intersection at East and North that there really isn't enough room to consider taking a two-lane turn and dropping it again before the next intersection, which has a very tight right-of-way.
With that additional island, like where the island where our town sign is, where that land is there, is there any way that could, like a realignment of that to make it skewed up there? I understand the existing roadway conditions would make it difficult for those turning lanes because we see the trucks constantly taking those turns and they drive over the edge lines. You can see the ruts where the road is and where they go on the dirt shoulder. But is there any way, like that island that's out there in front of the bank and where right now there's the addition where that street comes up going out to 38, is there any way to realign that, to add that? So we head over to the left right before where the fire station is and where the bank, where that island land is, where the sign is. Is there any way to realign that so it makes it easier to put a turning lane going up there?
Well, so there is one dedicated turn lane up there now. To add a second, the difficulty is accommodating it on this stretch of East Street between this intersection and the intersection of East and North. Because you would have two lanes turn, but then they immediately need to merge back down to one because you only have a single lane approach it, East and North, which has a tight right of way. And if we try to flare east out in the other direction, we end up clipping some of these driveways. So we did start to look at some of that, but it got very difficult in this East Street leg. And I'm wondering if I have the number on me. I will see if I can pull up the number quick as we continue to talk. We did run that, though, from an analysis perspective, putting one additional lane from Main Street, making the left onto East. It did improve it, but if I'm remembering correctly, it wasn't by much.
I would like to see that analysis before the final recommendation is made. Okay. So I even if it's right now, when vehicles are turning, especially trucks are turning up there, they tend to block other traffic.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, if somebody's coming around that corner, a truck will block that whole intersection. So that was my point. Even if we could get them out of the intersection, that they tend to block the whole lanes of traffic and get them up there. I mean, we know when they get up to the next thing, there's a blinking light at the next intersection of North Lee Street. So they're gonna, you're gonna have vehicles going there as well. But even if we can make it wider so that the trucks could make that turn a little bit easier and not block that intersection to get out of the way, and open up the whole intersection, I would think that would alleviate a little bit of traffic, because I don't know how many times I've driven through there and a truck is trying to make that turn and a car's there and it's so narrow that instead of easily making the turn, they end up slowing down or stopping, and it tends to back people up. So.
Okay.
I don't want to keep going on. I got a bunch, but I'll let everybody else have their say.
Mark, if I can ask a question here. Are you talking about people on Main Street making that left-hand turn on the east?
Specifically trucks.
Okay.
There's a lot of trucks that go up to, we have Market Basket up there. We have other reasons for trucks to go through that area. And there's going to be another large industrial project that's going on at the intersection of Daskam that's going to be going on up there. And I think when that's under construction specifically, every trucker that has waves is going to get off 495 and they're going to be driving down 38 and they're going to be looking to go there, because while that whole development is under construction, which probably will take at least 2 years, a typical construction project for them to phase that all in. And then even when it's built, trucks are going to go there. So, you know, I'm thinking we're building a school at the same time they're building a new development. And when that gets done, I wouldn't be surprised if all that land that's up there, the DuPont thing, that gets developed. So I see a lot of development coming in the future. I see a lot of trucks going down that roadway. And I want the everyday pedestrian, everyday residential vehicles to be able to use 38 to get up and down, to get to work, get people to school, do all those things. And I don't want the trucks blocking the intersection. And I think a lot of it coming from 495 heading up East Street is a big factor in that intersection. And especially when we get school buses. School buses are going to be making those turns as well. So I want it as easy as possible for turning lanes to be wide enough that a vehicle can make that turn easily to get up and down. So the trucks can get out of the way, the school buses can get out of the way, and then the regular residential vehicles can move along and get to where they need to get to.
All right, very good stuff, Mr. Kratman. How about who's next on the lineup? How about Mr. Bob Fowler? Comments? I thought we had Bob.
Bob, you're muted.
I think we lost Bob. So why don't we jump? How about Mr. Fataya?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and members of the Select Board. And thank you for the presentation, Amy. I guess my concerns are the fact that we are going to be taking away some of the town center area in order to facilitate a left turn onto Main Street. Is that correct?
You're looking at the strip being removed here for the widening?
Yeah, if you want to put a second lane going left onto Main Street from Pleasant, in order to facilitate that, how is that going to happen? We're taking
yes, so we widen this one lane. Within the area of the existing fire station, it's generally within the pavement of that existing apron. And then for this stretch from north of the existing driveway there up to the intersection, there's one lane worth of widening of pavement.
So we're not taking too much of that town center strip at all?
There's not much there. Yeah, it's about a 10-foot strip for this stretch between the north end of the existing driveway up to the sidewalk. But the you can kind of see in the aerial here the major components or features within the town common. Those were not affected.
Okay. So my other concern is on your design is coming up East Street onto Main, taking that right. It seems very close to the intersection for people to yield and come onto Main Street. Is that going to be a problem, people coming in where it's so close?
For the turn from East Street onto Main?
Yes, correct.
Well, we want it at the intersection, so if there is a green, they know they have the green and they can move freely. If they have a red, then they would come here to the yield and still be able to proceed after looking. We tried to make sure that you actually want to keep it closer to the intersection to make sure the pedestrian accommodations are still incorporated within the intersection. You also have the vehicles looking for any bicyclists coming through the intersection at this point. Okay. So it's generally flared out just enough to accommodate one vehicle between the yield position and the crosswalk.
Okay, I guess I'll ask one more question and let some others ask, but exiting the church, coming out, do you see that a problem with all the traffic coming on there now? Now they have access to go left or right. The only option they have now is to come out and to that Main Street and then go left or right, correct?
Right. So the intent here, like I said, the current position comes out on the East Street pretty close to the stop bar. So you have a queue that backs up here. You're basically introducing another conflict point very close to the intersection. This functions as another stop-controlled intersection itself. So this circulation would allow for two-way movement around the church parcel, but moves its point of intersection with the roadway further from the intersection. During the longest queue, this may back up towards that, but during most times of the day, we expect that this lane can continue to flush and not back up to the access point of that church lot.
Okay. What is the cost factor for this project?
We have not yet developed a cost estimate.
Okay.
So this alternative, I will say though, does hold. If this is what we ended up going with, we did maintain the movements along Main Street from the project already approved by MassDOT. So there would be little reconstruction along Main Street itself, other than the adjustment of the curb line on this side, on the north. And then Pleasant is being widened, as I mentioned, and East Street is being widened as well.
Okay. All right. So I'll leave you with my final opinion after seeing this and hearing that and so forth. I'm not crazy about it. I think the cost factor, what we're going to gain by putting in this yield to the right, is not that great, I would think. I would think our biggest concern would be taking a left off of Pleasant Street. I'd be all in favor of taking a second left off of Pleasant Street to Main.
Hello.
But I'm just not crazy about the entire project myself, but that's just my opinion. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Fataya. How about Ms. Wellman?
Okay.
All right, thank you, Mr. Chairman. All right. Nice to see everybody here tonight. Thank you, Amy, for your input this evening. I wanted Mr. Kratman and Mr. Fataya asked a couple of questions that I had as well, so I'll try to keep it brief. I think the left-hand turn from Pleasant onto Main Street is going to be key in sustainability down the road. How is the signalization recommendation going to dovetail with this lane configuration such that you can actually move people out of that? Because right now, you can sit there and want to go left forever, but you can't with the current signalization. What's your recommendation with that?
So we'd be looking to add both the lane and signal heads for that left turn movement. We're also trying to pull that back so it can queue separately, so people that are going straight and right aren't blocking people in the left. The two combined will generally help that flush more steadily.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Is the same, are you going to, on the Main Street portions, are you going to do left turn? We currently have some of that left turn dedication on the on the eastbound side, but not so much the westbound side during those
queues? So we did check running them concurrently, and we found that it, based on the volumes and the demand of the different left turns, it does make sense to continue the eastbound left as the lead left, and then the through movements concurrent. But we did check both of those. We looked at the possibility of making both the eastbound and westbound a lead, but it limited the through movements a little bit too much. Your through movements are still heavy enough that you want to make sure you're fully servicing them with enough time as well.
I think that in the morning, in the AM peak, that left turn on the westbound portion from Main onto Pleasant is pretty heavy, and it pushes traffic off onto side streets. I know a lot of people, particularly high school students, take side streets to get to their destination on that parcel. So if that's a partial solution, you know, an AM peak, that might be something worth exploring with the data set that you have. I do think we should widen Pleasant Street, and I don't have an issue with the right turn yield based portion from east on Main, especially if it's going to make it safer for visibility and for signalization for our fire station. And I haven't spoken to that yet, and so I'd love if you could speak to that a little bit. And then finally, and then I'll stop talking, if you could talk a little bit about what's the decision horizon that needs to be done before we need to get into Mass DOT as this paving project's going to go to bid next fall. We have to have these decisions made because I don't want to push out that project. I don't know if you know what that would be. And thank you.
So, yeah, that project is moving on its trajectory, and that was part of, like I was saying, why we were trying to tie into it to the extent possible. I think the less that we can have to reconstruct once it happens, it is generally good for everybody. It's less overall disturbance. It may end up blending the two construction timeframes together. The timeline for MassDOT, so they meet a few times a year to discuss potential TIP funding. They have a meeting coming up in December, but that might be a little soon. They generally like to see at least an advanced concept, or more preferably a 25% design. They will have the local MPO review it. They kind of give it a grading, and then they'll determine if it gets put on the TIP. And most projects, once approved, are put at least a couple to a few years out on the TIP. So we're certainly thinking that the Main Street Route 38 project is going to be fully underway before the other one would be able to get started if it goes MassDOT funding. Mm-hmm. But we are trying to align ourselves with getting on the next upcoming review if it's not December. I don't think they've listed the dates for next year. I've been trying to keep an eye out for it. But it's almost quarterly, so I would expect it might be sometime around March, the next one at the beginning of next year.
Great. And the other question is if you can discuss how this is going to affect our fire station outflow.
So maintaining this as a signalized intersection can be coordinated with the fire station. That's actually part of what we have submitted to MassDOT for review already with the fire station project. If the emergency preemption is tripped at the fire station, can it also trigger this intersection to make sure that eastbound leg of Main Street is flushed before the vehicles from the fire station even get all the way here? So there are emitters essentially that can coordinate that signal between the two intersections from where the fire station is going to let out in here.
Okay, very good. Thank you, Mr. Palmer. How about we go back to Mr. Bob Fowler?
Hello there. How are you?
Very good.
Nice to hear you, Jay. Question for you. Amy, the island in the middle, this is pedestrian traffic. We'll get off the cars for a second. Is that all right?
Sure.
Okay. The pedestrian traffic coming from, let's say, the bank, is that an island that That's not a raised island, just a painted island or rumble strip or what?
Between the main movement on East Street and the channelized?
Yes, from the black.
That actually has enough room to actually be a raised island.
Okay.
Yeah, and it's beyond the movement of where a truck would be coming from this left from Main to East. So, you know, we would want to make sure that it wouldn't interfere with any turn movements within the intersection.
Do you feel comfortable with the fact that, let's say someone's walking across and all of a sudden they lose their walking light? And they're in the middle of the island, in vehicles going left and right of them. Could that be a nervous thing for some people? Or do you feel that the timing of the lights should be sufficient enough so that they would be able to go across the black hash mark and over to whatever white one they want, left or straight across?
So I will double check, but I believe this island is at least 100 square feet. We generally try to make sure it does meet the minimum for refuge. So you try to make sure the person has at least a little bit of an offset in each direction so they don't feel like they're standing right on the edge. the movement behind them here, since it has a yield control, that should also be happening very slowly.
Right.
And then if a person is crossing from one of the white legs here and they end up on the island, then to cross here, that was why I think I mentioned previously, the yield marks are typically 20 to 25 feet in front of the crosswalk. So if you have one vehicle paused there waiting, the pedestrian can pass behind one vehicle and in front of the rest of the queue. So they're not stranded on the island until the next phase of the cycle. They have the ability to cross behind one queued up vehicle.
All right. Thank you, Amy. The getting back to the cars and the timing and all of that, I think it's a little premature for us to be critical of the design or questioning the design. We all can see that the problems that could take place. And really, the big thing is the tractor trailers that come around that corner, which Mark Kratman spoke about very, very well. And they get hung up there. You get buses coming down Pleasant Street going across, and a tractor trailer comes around down Route 38, taking a left behind them. It could be a very busy intersection. I don't know what we can do about that other than at a conference. And you can't blame Market Basket totally because they have their trucks not going that way. But it's the ones that come, the gypsies that come from Arizona and wherever, Maine and down 495, both north and south. So it's just a tough situation there. And I would hope that it will work out for the better, but Amy, thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Fowler. How about Mr. Eric Ryder?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Amy. There's a couple concerns. Obviously, I travel that road significantly. Pleasant Street, I'm a bit concerned. I like the left turn lane. I think that's critical. One of the big problems is the intersection at East at North. If a vehicle, specifically 4 o'clock in the afternoon, you will not, if a car is taking a left-hand turn off of East onto North, you will not, you only have about 20, maybe 14 cars, 20 cars. You have 3 or 4 buses there. So you back up that whole leg carrying through that intersection. Have you looked at how you intend on moving traffic through that intersection in conjunction with East and North? Because I think if we don't address East and North along with this, we're only going to push traffic, and we're going to bottleneck at that location.
I understand your point, Eric. And that was part of what I was saying before too. We can't, although we could widen Main to send even more traffic up that leg of East, you have to be able to handle it before it approaches the north intersection. It's a very short leg.
Correct. Have you looked at signalization at that intersection to timed in conjunction with the intersection of moving traffic off of Pleasant Street onto East and through that East North Street intersection, and potentially looking at a turning lane onto North Street with the ability to move traffic? It looks as if you would have room from land to put a left turn lane. And then what are you trying to achieve for lane width as well?
So as far as scope goes, the focus of our scope has been this intersection thus far. We have not analyzed the adjacent intersection or potential coordination between the two. That may be something the town wants us to consider. We haven't gone there yet or added that to the scope. For lane widths, we're trying to make sure we maintain at least a minimum 11. That is what the DOT plan had on Main Street, plus the 5-foot bike lanes in each direction. As I mentioned, a couple areas where we tried to go wider, this turn from East Street onto Main, we have flaring out as it turns. That was based on a truck movement. Obviously, with it turning, it's going to bow a little bit towards the inside. So we flared that lane. We also have, it's a little hard to see, maybe if I zoom in a little bit more. We have a small taper here with the primary through movement on East pulls to the side a little bit, and the eastbound lane is bumped over. That's to help accommodate left turns from Main Street onto East without encroaching on the person sitting there. I don't remember the measurement specifically of both of those, but I think you can see the shoulder here as well now that I zoomed in a little. Those were the two main areas where we tried to flare the pavement to try to accommodate some of those heavier truck movements.
Okay, have you looked at also addressing a couple of the members, Mr. Kratman's and Mr. Fataya's left-hand turn off of Main onto East? Have you looked at pulling that stop bar back to the front of the island to give yourself a wider turning radius and not potentially cause a backup?
I will double check that truck turn, and that is a very viable solution if the truck is still encroaching on that stop bar.
Okay. I will say again, as the chairman stated, this is going to be here for the next 50 years. Hopefully I'm still in town and driving through that. But I think if we don't look at the other intersection in conjunction with this, we're just kicking the ball down the road. I really think we need to look at those two in conjunction, because right now with just the one school, and right now it's difficult with the number of students in school right now, but if we go back to last spring with just two schools coming off Pleasant Street, we're adding another school, we are going to see significant backups through that East Street, North Street exchange. And I think we need to be cognizant of that. And thank you again for all your work.
Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you, Mr. Ryan. How about Ms. Stronach?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate that. Lots of good questions from the other members, and I appreciate the planning board being here tonight. So I want to recognize the special event of tonight. I appreciate that. And thank you for making that happen, Mr. Chairman. I did like the points brought up by Mr. Ryder, Mr. Battelli, and I also believe Mr. Kratman about the viable solution that you just spoke about, Amy. I travel, this is, I can't get out of my house without going down this road, basically. And so I understand the need, but I do think that the cost is a factor that has to be considered, to Mr. Fatalia's point. And more importantly, the one question that I have is, what is the impact on the residents in those driveways, and how does one even go about obtaining that? Is that something that we have to get permission for? Is that something that we just do? I was wondering how that works, because I'm familiar with that. I'm sure the planning board has a better idea of that than I do, so indulge me.
So the full process, maybe someone from the town could comment on, or maybe Lance has looked into that a little bit, but I will point out that the modifications that we're making are within the right-of-way.
Okay.
Yep.
How impactful would it be on those neighboring people in their driveways? I'm curious.
I don't know if any of those people happen to be on. It would be interesting to hear from them, and I'm sure coordination would take place as we move forward, but our thought and our intent was to try, as I said, to move their point of access to the road further from the intersection, which the intent is to make it easier for them to get on and off of the main roads. Their driveway comes out into the road at a point where they're constantly stuck behind a queue, that's frustrating, and it's difficult to get in and out. And particularly if you're turning up E Street and then trying to turn into a driveway, you could be backing up cars into the intersection. So we looked at it as a means of pulling those people further back from the intersection, trying to give them more opportunity to not get caught in a queue, and trying to improve safety by not having cars back up into the intersection.
Terrific. I just not as familiar with the process and how that works, but I look forward to engaging those residents before this goes any further. I know that tonight is just an overview meeting for us. So, and I have no other questions, Mr. Chairman. Thank you very much.
Perfect. How about Mr. Steve Johnson?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So I mean, we've gotten through a lot of sort of the questions here, but I guess just to back up a step, I think, at least from my perspective, one of the things that I think is one of the biggest factors here is to what exactly are we aiming for here? Because this is the town center. I mean, how fast do we really think people are going to get through the center of town? Like, what is the actual, I mean, we want things to move, I get that. But the fact of the matter is, this is town center. And, you know, at one end, depending on which street you're talking about, you've got 93. At the other end, you got 495, as places that you're trying to get to. And logistically, you have a problem, which is there's very, very, very few parallel ways to get through Tewksbury. You're basically talking about 133 and Whipple. There are no other crossways to direct anybody who wants to do anything else to get across our town. So everybody's pretty much forced to go through and over 38. So, I mean, I know we want it to work as well as possible, but I just don't know, are we being realistic about exactly how fast we think people are going to get through the center of town with what's there and what may be there in the future. That's part of it. You know, when there really aren't a lot of options to divert any kind of traffic to move from one side, or north, basically to move from south to north, or north to south, because there's things in the way that prevent any other cross streets from people that, you know, maybe people who are from town, knowing, you know, sort of the cheats and getting out of the way so that, you know, the people who are actually just kind of traveling through, you know, are sticking to the main road. We just don't have that here. I know the other one we mentioned, the trucks. I had asked a question a while back. I don't know if there was ever a final answer, but what I understood about it was that our efforts in the past to try and limit trucks on East Street so they wouldn't come down into this section of town are limited because in order to do that kind of restriction, we need a sign off from Andover, which, you know, everybody knows my feelings about Andover. So I hate the idea that they have to sign off on anything that we want or need. But what I had asked was, okay, we're not allowed to touch without their okay. Well, that last little piece right there is actually Pleasant Street. It's not East Street. It becomes East Street shortly thereafter. But if you were to limit truck traffic on East Street, that piece of North, Chandler and Livingston, at the lower sections, then trucks wouldn't be able to use this as a cut through. They'd be forced to go where they should be going to begin with, which is off of 93 and coming down into Dasco. But I'm not really sure if there's any limitation on us placing those restrictions on the roads that are really just ours, that aren't East Street. So I don't know if that's an option, but I know we were limited for East Street, but I didn't know if that might be a workaround as a way to accomplish what we wanted without having to ask permission. And then it would alleviate some of this truck issue that we have, and especially in this intersection where trucks want to come up 495, come down and hang this left right in the middle of our town that certainly causes problems to a lot of people. So I don't know, like I said, I don't know all the ins and outs of that, but whether that's an option, I don't know. As far as the design, one of my questions, because it's hard to scale here, but how many vehicles do you think can queue up coming down East Street, and then if they were going to be going straight down Pleasant, how many vehicles could queue up at that light before they're going to be in the way of cars trying to get into this new right lane yield lane? Yield lane.
So we did look at the queue for vehicles coming through East Street, and we tried to make sure that during those parts of the day, this is clear. So it is a little hard to see here, but this turns the bend and has enough room for a vehicle until close to this point. Let me double check my
scale. No, but what my question is the cars that are going to be stopped.
Yes, they're queued here. So I believe we had over 100 feet. We were trying to get at least 100 feet, which is a 4 to 5 car queue that could be backed up at the stop line on East Street before it would block a person trying to get over to that channelized right turn lane.
Hmm. Right. So, I mean, I don't know, do we, at a peak time, is 4 or 5 cars going to more than likely be there? Meaning now nobody can get by to get into that new lane where they would normally have gone right past in front of the church. And by the way, I hate that lane that goes by the church. So I'm not in favor of keeping that. It's just, I wonder, does this curve need to be bigger and go a little bit more into the green to create a little more space for more cars to get by? Because if you do get busy, then you start backing up to, as Mr. Ryder pointed out, now your next problem is if people start backing up, now you're in the way of North and East Street. And it's just going to make it even worse. I know that was beyond your scope in terms of how to deal with it, but if this backs up, then you got a real problem.
We did look at trying to flare that more. It's a slightly different color gray here, but if you see this thin band next to the travel lanes, that is also the sidewalk accommodation. So we are pretty close between the roadway and sidewalk and where these driveways need to come out. So trying to flare it more would start to encroach on that. We would probably have to pull at least one more driveway in the east, but then it would be coming out in the area where that is flaring. So like I said, we did look at pulling this curve out sooner to try to give it a longer length back. But even from here to here isn't 200 feet. So you're not gonna get more than like another 3 cars to be able to queue, even if you pulled it off straight here and it came through where this drive is shown right now.
Yeah, and I don't know exactly what the queue is gonna look like. Obviously, it's a big change because sometimes you can have, you know, numerous cars lined up in that sort of bypass where East goes over to the bank before it jumps onto 38. Mm-hmm. It's just, if those cars can't get by to get into this new lane and you've people stopped at the light, that's going to back up real fast, real foul. So that feels like that's a consideration that has to be figured out as to whether you have to push for that bigger flare or not. Because otherwise, what you design, not you personally, but what's designed here, you're not going to get the benefit certainly on that side of it, that you might get from these other the other changes on the other side, you know, with the left only lane.
So just to point out, the geometry of this is taken into account in the analysis tool. It looks at the radius of this curve. It looks at how far back it is from this stop bar. So if we didn't put the channelized right in, but your average delay here, looking at this again, was a little over 56 seconds. So it is showing that you're getting enough people moving there that you can give less time to this leg, which gives more time to the other legs, which is improving overall level of service. So I think this would certainly be worth putting in. It seems like it's giving that overall improvement. There are some times of the day where you'll get a long enough queue that it at least temporarily blocks part of this. But the volumes were almost 50-50 here. So if you think every other car approaching this direction is trying to go that way, you should be able to get at least as many cars to go that way as you're getting to go this way, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I mean, I'm in favor of the closing off that other road and creating this. I was just concerned about how the queuing could lessen its use or its effectiveness, I guess. But that's about it, I guess, for me. I think having the stuff just line up correctly would make a huge difference, which we do not have now. The intersection does not line up correctly.
Right.
Sometimes you're driving directly at a car coming towards you, even though it's not like in normal places where you're trying to pull, take a left or something. And this is like oncoming traffic, the way it's lined up. Even that alone should help some of this, just lining things up.
Mm-hmm.
But that's it for me. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. How about Mr. Jay Delaney?
Hi, Amy. This is Jay Delaney. If you can hear me.
I can.
Okay. The concern of the planning board in the very, very beginning, okay, a big concern was the left-hand turn from Main Street onto E Street. Okay, so the thing is, what we have here now is that as wide as we can make that entrance into E Street so that the trucks, I'm concerned about the fire truck too, coming around that corner, not impeding into the other lane. Are we going to have enough room at that intersection, or are we making that wide enough right now for that? And the other concern that I have is what they're all talking about was the coordination from North Street, the North Street intersection. That seems, you know, there are nights when you go there and you try to make a left-hand turn onto North Street, and you know, you're waiting more than 5 minutes a lot of the times. So what Mr. Ryder is talking about is that there's a lot of truth to that. But to make this center work, I think we have to also concentrate on the North Street intersection. I think that has to be a part of it. Along with widening as wide as we can get it, the turn from Main Street onto E Street. Another thing is the cost. The cost of this, I was just wondering, you know, when a lot of times when people build things, they include infrastructure in the cost of the project. I was just wondering why with such a dramatic change to the infrastructure of the center of town because of the schools and this and that, why that price couldn't have been included into the price of fixing this intersection, because they knew it was going to be a problem when we were going through the process with the schools. Those are just some of the things that I have, but the big thing is the North Street intersection, I think, has to be addressed in order to make this here work. You know, the right-hand turn onto Main Street from E Street, that right-hand turn at night will back up you know, you're only moving four or five cars, but you got to get the four or five cars to that intersection, to that lane. And how that's going to happen at this point, I don't know. In the key times are around that 4 o'clock to 6 o'clock at night, from what I see, or from when I drive it. So those are my concerns. And I want to thank you. You guys have done a great job giving us an idea. I just don't know how much of an inconvenience it's going to be for the people that live there, the bank, the church, you know, how much of a convenience when construction starts, how much of an inconvenience it's going to be for everybody in there. Okay. That's another thing that has to be considered, because they are part of our town and so forth. So I really think the inconvenience of the construction has got to be mapped out and really gone through completely before we even start this project. And that's it for me. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Delaney. All right, so I'll add a few pieces, and what I'll do is I'll reopen up to the board only if you had anything new or just want to speak for a minute or so. So I'll just start. Here's the deal. First off, the sky is not falling. I always like to preference that. But for me, something needs to be done. Amy, I think you say a little bit fancier. The level of service needs to improve. I think we're saying the same things, just differently. I also understand that this could take, you know, this doesn't happen overnight. I mean, heck, we've been living with the 38 nightmare now for quite some time. Now we're making strides. We have many sections of 38 within the tip, but in the next couple of years, they're going to get done. But I also understand that this might not take place till 2025, or knowing 38 or knowing Mass, maybe 2030. I don't know, but I know this is where it starts. This is where the conversation starts, the planning starts, and it's not going to happen overnight. Love the fact that we brought up a cost. There's always an associated cost. If we choose to do nothing, you know, there's no cost. But if there's always an associated cost for whatever we're doing, and there's a cost for even the team to pull this together. So for me, I just don't want to be – sometimes we drive around other towns and cities and say, why did they do this? You know, what were they thinking? I just don't want Tewksbury to be that town for something that is so important as our center. We all know about the congestion. I think it's only going to get worse. And again, that's why we're at the table, the virtual table, so to speak, having these conversations. So what I'd like to do is open it back up to the board again, if you have another comment or two. And what I'd like to do is for the select board to send questions my way, and I'll feed those to Montori. And the same deal for the planning board. Please bubble those up to Bob, Mr. Fowler, and we'll take all the questions, all the concerns, and then we'll feed those back into Amy and team and revisit this, because I don't think we're there yet. But again, this is the only the second draft, the second iteration. I think we're moving in the right direction. So I will pause there. Does anyone else, because I know some folks went a while ago, does anyone else want to grab the floor for another minute or so based on all the conversation that we've had?
Now, Jay, this is Bob Fowler.
Please.
Just to let you know, I'm all set. I mean, we all know that the biggest problem is going from the north side to Pleasant Street to north. So that's been addressed by, I think, every one of us. So I don't want to reiterate any more about that. Thank you.
No, that's fair. And I just think, to Mr. Johnson's point, I see a lot of green there. You know, the first draft, I said, hey, let's go back. We have to be bold. I keep on saying this is, you know, for the next 50 to 100 years here, how do we – I know it's a town center, and we have to preserve, like, the integrity of the town center, but we also know we're faced with big challenges today and tomorrow and the years ahead of us. So, you know, now's the time to put our heads together and see how we make it, you know, better for the long haul. That's all.
Mr. Chairman, I understand we're in the design phase. I understand we're all looking at this intersection, but we get some major infrastructure that's happening around here. We have the new school, the new fire station, and we get that major development that's going to be happening up in Daskam. We can't control some of them, but you know, when that Mass Works grant project begins on 93 at Daskam, this project here or not, is going to cause a major infrastructure problem for us, a major traffic problem for us, because while that project is under construction, I am 100% convinced that that's going to show up on every trucker's waves saying that that intersection is under construction. Use 38. So that means everybody's going to be coming to 495, going down 38. Market Basket does an unbelievable job telling their truckers, their own drivers, to not go down 38. They tell them, they give them instructions, go to 495 to 93 to get off at Nascom and go that way. But once that goes under construction, I think we're going to have an incredible amount of trucks that's going to come through this intersection. So as that happens, we got to keep that in consideration, and we have to work with, unfortunately, you know, the other community. We have to work with Andover. We're going to have to work with the state. We're going to need to have updates. And I don't know if we can, you know, this intersection all on, you know, as we're doing it, but we're also going to have to work with the state to see what kind of mitigation they're going to do for us. To expedite these types of problems. I know they're talking about putting it down the road, but if we're going to have to deal with that traffic, we should put the pressure on the state saying, how are you helping us? You're sending hundreds of trucks down our main thoroughfare. That's going to affect our schools, our businesses, everything. You know, so they should be giving us additional funding to for our problems, for the inconvenience that we're going to be dealing with. And I don't know how else to say it, but you know, how are they dealing with it when everybody, when that intersection is all completely torn up in 2 years, we have to deal with 2 years of trucks coming up and down our road. Kids go back to school. This is going to be a nightmare of that happening. So I greatly thank everybody who come to look at this, but I think we really need to take a look at this and do the best we can to alleviate that problem. The problem's coming one way or another. We just have to work to resolve it. That's all I have, Mr. Chairman.
All right. Anyone else before we close?
Mr. Chair, if I can, just for a moment, just to address the trucking and no trucking stipulations on roads. Typically, in my experience, they've been very challenging to get no trucking on roads, and I'm talking even just residential roads, much less roads that have a little bit more commerce on them. So I can certainly understand the thought process on this East Ave and Pleasant Street side of the street there. But one thing that makes it kind of hard for the police is how you go about regulating which trucks can use that road or not. Because no matter what happens, if you put no trucking on there, it's no through trucking. They still allow for trucks to utilize the roads in order to do local deliveries and other things like that. Right. So I only put that out there for just some thinking there that's oftentimes a challenge.
Yeah. Mr. Martori and I worked with Andover probably, I don't know, I think back in May. Simply put, to get a few, to get some, have this truck stop essentially flowing from 6 p.m. to 4 a.m. because we have some cut through streets on East Street, and the planning board or the Board of Selectmen in Andover, they chose to take no action, which was very disappointing. But anyhow.
Understood, yeah.
Okay, listen, if there's no other questions, why don't we do this? Again, we still have some questions from the select board side, so I want to have the board bubble those up to me. We'll feed those to Montori, and I would ask the same for the planning board side. Seems like you guys have some very valid questions and points, especially around the other intersections that we may want to consider. So I still think we're in the design phase. We have some more homework to do, so let's try to bubble those questions up, and we'll meet sooner than later if that's reasonable.
Thank you, Jay.
All right. Thank you, Lance. Thank you, Amy. Thank you, team.
Thank you for your time. Appreciate it.
Thank you. All right. Last but not least, team, we have on the agenda sidewalks. So, again, just the preference. the planning board has been talking about sidewalks. We typically talk about sidewalks. I know we get a lot of calls from sidewalks. So in no way, shape, or form did we want to – this isn't about asking you, the planning board, for money or to get your thoughts, but more or less to say, hey, if we're both talking about sidewalks, very much almost like Pleasant Street and Main Street here, do we have some synergy? Do we want to kind of put our collective thoughts together moving forward, I guess, so we're all on the same page, I guess, as a town? Not saying we're not. So that's it. So really no secret agenda. I don't know if we just want to have an open roundtable discussion. I don't believe we had anything to share. I don't know if Ms. McGinty had anything to share or if we had anything to share. But again, very open conversation about sidewalks. I know we're planning, and Mr. Martori and Steve, and we have Kevin Hardiman on the meeting. Right now the focus is on Shawsheen. I don't believe it requires any additional funding from the planning board budget. But I don't know if, like you said, we can absolutely talk about roundtable or maybe just table this for the next time we really talk about sidewalks. Again, have that synergy, and so we're all on the same page. So very kind of a loose agenda when it came to the sidewalks here as opposed to what we just discussed. That's all.
Thank you, Jay. This is Bob Fowler. I like what you the draft that you have of the next 4 or 5 years for different sections of town for sidewalks. I think that's eye-opening, and it looks like you're on the right page as far as getting things done. That way, when you know, what I like about it is the fact that when you come before the town meeting, you're looking for funding for something for FY 23 or 24, people will anticipate that, and they'll understand why it's there, and they'll have the long, you know, the five-year plan as it is. I'm happy with that, and I like the idea that you're starting. Well, Shawsheen Street was already approved, but starting on Main Street. Main Street obviously has the most traffic, and we want to make it pedestrian safe. There are areas on Main Street where there is little or no sidewalk, and we have to do something to alleviate that problem. And for the safety of all included, there are some places that were done incorrectly, such as down in front of Walmart. The state wouldn't put a sidewalk on the Walmart side, so people sometimes leave Walmart or that area and they walk down the street because they don't want to go up to the traffic light, which is only 50 feet away, and cross over to the other side to use the sidewalk. So nothing we can do about that because of the bridge. But there are other things that we can do in other places. So there are places on Main Street where there are no sidewalks, east or west side. So that's why what we have to address. And again, thank you. As I said, the potential sidewalk locations are spot on. So I thank you for that. And I'm all set. Thank you.
Okay. How about other members of any board? We talked about, you know, there's not a street. We talked about safety first, and to your point, even Shawsheen Street. I mean, it's just we're in desperate need for a lot of streets. We have a master plan, you know, and year over year, funds are allocated to those plans, and sometimes we have to get additional funds, and which is the case for Shawsheen Street. So we know it's a need. I always say there's four things we hear as a board: taxes, water, sewer, then sidewalks is absolutely fourth, and I think we're nailing that. So how about other members of the board? Any other conversations around sidewalks? And again, if you have like a solution or strategy, welcome to hear it.
Mr. Chairman, love to step
please.
In. So one of the discussions we've had and one of the conversations we've had with the community when we've had open community meetings has always been connectivity. We're building sidewalks. Where do they lead to? Why are they there? And how do they benefit the community? So I know we've built a number of them, and we joined the Complete Streets program. By following their guidelines, we've got additional state funding. And I know the state is putting, I mean, the town has been putting up their portion, and we've been, you know, budgeting $200,000, $250,000. But by joining this Complete Streets program, we got an additional $400,000. So over the next couple of years, we'll have $650,000 to be putting toward these sidewalks. I know planning department, Kevin, engineer, has looked at that. He's listened to the residents about what they're asking for. He's taken that into consideration when designing a number of these. But when it comes to Route 38, I think we really need to start putting some pressure on our delegation. It's absolutely ridiculous that our main roadway, Route 38, does not have sidewalks from the city line to the town line. I understand that there's a lot of reasonings for it. There's some of the area down by the power lines, there's no homes there. There's no real businesses there. It's wet down there. But when you go from one side or the other, there is. You know, we built, you know, in the community, we bought, you know, a developer built a beautiful bowling alley, a beautiful place for kids to go to. And if you live, you know, a half a mile away, you have to ride your bike or walk in the middle of the street. That's absolutely unacceptable as far as I'm concerned. And so I know we've had a number of, we've lobbied, we've pushed for a number of resurfacing projects. So we end up, we got, you know, Lowell to Pike, Pike to Old Boston. We have Old Boston to Colonial on the books. We got Salem and South under construction. But we've worked with our town engineer to ask him to put together a plan to show us where those, where everything is and where on the tip everything is. We should be taking that plan and taking everything that's left out and having our delegation sending something to the Secretary of Transportation saying, we understand this is under construction. We understand. But and healthy transportation is what the state always talks about. You know, under the new plan where they're going from Old Boston Road to Colonial, they're adding sidewalks and bicycle accommodations. But what's going to happen is those bicycle accommodations are going to stop at Old Boston Road. So if somebody's riding their bike from Colonial to Old Boston Road, well, then you're left in a wetlands and no sidewalk on either side, no highway lighting. And I don't want my kid riding down there and getting to a place where it doesn't continue on. Our delegation should be fighting just to ask for additional funding, and there should be sidewalk improvements done along that. And we should ask them not if it's going to be done, but when it's going to be done. And I think a letter from our town, our planning department, our selectmen, everybody should be putting the pressure on them to say, when is this going to happen? And we need it in our community. If you drive around, if you go to any other town, you go to 28, you know, they have their main thoroughfares. You know, 3A is the town road for Billerica. Well, they have sidewalks going through their whole thing. You drive on 28, they have sidewalks in North Reading. You know, so why don't we have them in Tewksbury? And it's about time that we really start putting the pressure to get it done.
So, Mark, I don't think we need a vote. I don't think we need a vote. So, Mr. Montori, obviously, we'll work with you here. I think it's, like I said, I don't think we need a vote here to engage with our delegation here and see what we can do. I guess the word apply pressure here, you know, from the state to help our community. And, again, I always want to leverage that state hospital. We have that state hospital there. They're very good neighbors. We come in peace. However, I still think that's a bargaining chip in our favor.
Mr. Chairman?
Please.
So maybe it's some of it's echoing, but I think I think it kind of goes along back with our traffic discussion that we just had, which is, I mean, we seem to still be designed like we're a little town from decades ago in terms of, you just named a lot of the surrounding towns who seem to have managed to figure out how to put sidewalks in. And you know, there's a lot more cars moving around Tewksbury or everywhere, but Tewksbury in particular we're talking about. And you don't really have a safe way to get from a place to a place in a lot of parts of the town. You know, I mean, right now, Livingston, Livingston is now ours, the parks. You know, it took forever to finally get, you know, control of that. But you can only actually really get there if you're, you know, a kid from one direction. If you want to stay on a sidewalk, You can't get there from if you were up at the baseball field. You can't come down there without taking your life in your hands for people going up and down Livingston. I mean, that seems crazy to me. And then you look at other sections of town, right where it stops being a neighboring town and there were sidewalks, it comes to a screeching halt once it gets to Tewksbury. And if you happen to be out there walking somewhere, you just went from the safety of a sidewalk to wondering where the cars are coming around the bend because you're now standing on the street. Or you have to stand in someone's front yard to try and walk across the grass to not get run over. The safety of people trying to get from one place to another is well, I mean, it's awful in a lot of sections, but it seems like the destination places like Livingston, they have to be done and they have to be places that people can get there from, you know, both ends or however you want to describe it. First and foremost, I mean, if you live up on the, you know, the upper side, you know, towards East Street, you know, you cannot safely get to Livingston Street Park if you have a game or a practice or a whatever coming down there. You know, you've got cars coming up and down. You've got buses coming up and down there. That just makes no sense, you know, that you can't get there from here for something as important as the biggest park and recreation section of town without, you know, dodging oncoming traffic. You know, we've got the roads are very thin in some places, and the sidewalks would be extremely helpful to keep people and get people to be able to move around, walk around town. You know, the piecemeal pots of sidewalks that we have just don't seem like they make a lot of sense with the way they just sort of end in places for us, or worse, where other towns have put them in and we're the end point. We just don't have anything to meet up with them. It can't be the road because somehow they managed to put a sidewalk in on the exact same road that we can't. That doesn't make any sense. So I mean, I think the sidewalks, you know, the sidewalks are incredibly important considering how much vehicular traffic there is existing now. You know, for us, for every other town, you know, more people drive. So we need safe places for people to walk. You know, that's just my thoughts on it. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Johnson. I think, please, go ahead, Ms. Wellman.
Briefly, we have our staff on this meeting, and I'm just wondering if there's any appetite to hear them kind of talk about their plan and their rationale for that development of it, because certainly we all can agree that there's a dearth of sidewalks in town. I think that it's good to have a plan and kind of understand that. And I know that there are some folks that are watching or may watch this later and may be interested in that information. But we also have to have a real conversation about budgeting that plan and how we want to fund it, because really that's what it comes down to. Not so far as the Main Street portion is, because that's a state issue. So, but we do have, you know, a number of our excellent staff who worked on these plans, and I think there may be some efficacy to hear from them. So thank you.
No, thank you. I was going to get there. I just wanted the board to speak. I mean, that's my takeaway here is, listen, we're focusing on, we do have a master plan, but it seems that we can get a little more detail. To Mr. Johnson's point is we really have to maybe not do it in piecemeal, but really take that master plan and go a step, you know, one more step to say, how do we connect all the dots before we might explore another area in town? That's kind of, I'm reading between the lines. But with that being said, Mr. Martori, Mr. Hardiman, I know we have Mr. Gilbert, Steve, the floor is yours. Maybe just want to kind of talk through some of these stuff that we just highlighted.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. I think at this time it's probably appropriate for the town engineer, Kevin Hardiman, to review the process that took place in developing the master plan. You know, just so everyone understands how we got to got us to the decisions that we've made. So, Kevin, why don't you just do that at a high level, and we can open up to questions.
Certainly. Thank you, Mr. Montori. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the boards. So when we undertook the pedestrian mobility master plan tasks, we really came up with a three-pronged approach to this. We were looking to connect destinations within the town. We were looking to install sidewalks along the main roads in town because it has the most impact and the most, I guess, bang for the buck, if you would. And then we're also looking to fill in gaps within our sidewalk network. And in doing so, we held a workshop. We got input from the public. We mapped out the town itself, looked at the roadways, looked at the constraints that we're going to be faced with in trying to construct sidewalks on the roadways. And that's where we developed our plan to move forward. And, we've developed, there are well over 60 segments of roadway on that plan. And we've outlined a 5-year master plan each year to start, really addressing those locations. The way I see it, looking at the plan is, over the next 5 years, we have the potential to knock off about 30% of those locations on that list. Obviously it's dependent on funding, but that's really our plan at this point.
Thank you, Kevin. I'll answer for you. Jay?
Please, Mr. Fowle, please.
No, I was waiting for you to speak.
No, I mean, I get it. I just think there was some, there's some questions about which ones we tackle first, where right. The budget comes. I think we addressed some of that. And I get it. I do believe we have to start connecting the dots, I'll say, for lack of better words. But I also think Shawsheen is one of those streets. I mean, I just call it a danger zone, and I think we have a lot of danger zones in town, but I'm absolutely unequivocally in favor of Shawsheen. But I also understand the fact that we got to start, like I say, connecting all the sidewalks so someone can go from East Street all the way up to Town Hall.
And Mr. Chairman, Kevin's put the... I think that's the best way you can put it. We've had public workshops. We've listened to the residents, and the DPW has been doing a wonderful job because one of the things they've been doing is they've been doing their latest resurfacing projects and installing the new sidewalks. Is that they've been taking photos and showing the community where their dollars are going. People have been always asking. It's like you keep talking about these things happening. Well, when is it going to happen? And, if you live on one side of town, you may not see it happening on the other end of town. But things are happening, and they've been doing what the residents have asked for. I think we can do a better job of getting that information out there. Because at any time you do a reconstruction or you're resurfacing or you add sidewalks, the first thing you're going to get is, how come not in this area? It all can't happen overnight. I understand there should be priorities and there should be connectivity of, if we do something and we're doing Livingston Street and then we're doing Shawsheen, people are going to be saying, well, what are we doing Whipple? When are we doing East Street? When are we doing this? We should probably say, funding appropriate, and this is how this is going to connect together. And I'd like to see more meetings of the selectmen and the planning board get together and have these discussions, because there's going to be development that's going to happen in this community. They're going to be reviewing construction plans or designs for something that's going to come forward. And as that takes place, this may change a little bit. So if somebody comes in and develops a section of East Street that hasn't been developed, and they're going to put some new development in there, and all of a sudden, we require sidewalks in there. Well, that may be a factor into us doing our connectivity. But what's going in there? Why do we need to change it? Why does the plan need to change? What, these things aren't going to happen. So I think Kevin's doing a pretty good job of following what the residents are asking for. But I think we really need to get that word out of how we came up with this plan, why they're following forward. And believe me, every point that I've heard, I agree with every single one of you. Yes, we need sidewalks going from East Street to Livingston Street. I think that should be a priority. But also, you can walk down Shawshin Street, and you can take your life in your hand walking down that street as well. You can walk down North Street, you can take your life in your hands walking down that. You walk down Whipple Street, same thing. There's way too many streets. I've been out there. I've walked them. I've seen them. And you come around a corner, and you're looking around a tree to see if a truck's bearing at you. We need more pedestrian access in this town. And I think we're getting there, but, you know, working together, we'll get there faster. And that's my point. I think we need to have more communication, keep everybody in the loop, and let's get this done as a team. So I'm looking forward to working with you all. That's all.
Mr. Chairman, I have a couple comments, if I could.
Please, Mr. Fatagle, please.
Thank you. Kevin, I know you're doing a great job with the sidewalks. I guess one of my questions would be, so we're focusing on more on the main streets of Tewksbury versus the side streets, correct?
Correct.
Okay. So with that said, is Pleasant Street completed, Kevin?
Pleasant Street?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Because in my drive today, looking around, I see Pleasant Street, but it just seems like it's incomplete as far as not having granite curbs all the way down or a berm down. And it just seems like it's not complete. So I wasn't sure, but I figured I would ask you. I mean, is that something we do on all roads? Berms or granite curbing?
No, we have to look at each road individually and see what treatment is appropriate for that. You know, one thing that we run into is the lack of drainage. We can't put in curbing unless we have an active drainage system with catch basins and outlet piping. You know, otherwise, we run the risk of creating puddles along the side of the road against the curbing. You know, so for example, the southern end of Pleasant Street down near Long Pond, because we don't have an active drainage system, we still have to maintain some sort of country drainage to get the water off the road, and therefore we can't put in that curbing.
Okay, well that explains it, because it looks doesn't look good because it's not a lot of finished road like you have on Main Street. So that was one of my questions, you know. And it seems like also as my travels around town that some roads, some sidewalks are concrete, some are tar. So how does that get determined by the project or funding, or how does that work?
So historically, that's been decided by funding. And, you know, we're trying to stretch the funding as much as we can. The cost of concrete is probably close to twice the cost of asphalt for the sidewalks. So we can get, you know, on average, twice as much sidewalk installed with asphalt than we can with concrete. You know, okay. So that's kind of the decision factor there.
Okay, another question I have for you. I don't want to put you on the spot, Kevin, because I wanted to get these questions answered myself, and I'm sure it may help some of our board members as well. As far as longevity between concrete and tar, are they pretty much the same?
It really depends on the location and installation. You know, the concrete can be susceptible to salt deterioration. You know, another reason why we try to steer away from concrete, aside from the cost, is the maintenance, upkeep, and repair of concrete. You know, the DPW typically doesn't have staff that can, you know, relay panels of concrete readily and dowel those into the existing concrete. So, you know, we are very adept at, you know, asphalt work and patching sidewalks, which are asphalt. So, you know, that's another factor for the decisions.
Okay. So I have couple more questions and I'll let you go. But as I drove today, as I came down East Street at the corner of Livingston Street in East, we have all concrete and then we go to tar as we get down towards the fields. I mean, if that's the case as far as concrete and the cost, why are we doing it there and not tar, I guess?
So the East Street intersection at Livingston, that was done prior to my getting here, but it's my understanding that was a TIP project that was funded through the state.
Right.
Okay.
You know, so sometimes there are additional requirements within the TIP for concrete versus asphalt as well. Okay.
That explains it. I like concrete myself better than tar. I think it looks a hell of a lot better, but, you know, that's it. But, I mean, I echo Mark's Kratman's concerns about sidewalks in the town. You know, what bothers me a lot is I see parents walking their children on the road. And, you know, in today's day and age with people on their phones and texting and so forth, it's an accident waiting to happen. So sidewalks can't get here fast enough, in my opinion. I've walked sidewalks my entire life being a letter carrier in the post office for 35 years. And I appreciate the fact that sidewalks are a big part of safety in the towns. I see parents walking up and down the sidewalks rather than the streets in the cities. In the country, it's different because there isn't anywhere else to go. So we don't have sidewalks everywhere. But and I don't think we'll ever get them here completely. But I think if we can concentrate on some of the main roads, some of the recreational facilities around here, like Long Pond and Livingston Street, where people travel more than some of the side roads, I think we'll all be better off as a community getting the sidewalks in. You know, I know it's a long yearly process, and I know I've seen the nice five-year outlook we have as far as sidewalks, but, you know, I just hope for the best, and hopefully we can get some funding. You know, as a planning board member, whenever a developer comes in and wants to put sidewalks in, and on one side of the road rather than both, I'm like, yes, in my opinion, I'd vote for that all the time because I know we have some funds coming into our sidewalk fund. So I think a lot of my planning board members will probably agree with that statement as well. If we can get some funding from developers and just do half of the development versus all of the development for sidewalks, it's a plus for all of us. So with that, I'll end. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Fataya. Good stuff. Any other members of the board?
Yeah, Mr. Chairman.
Please.
The thing is, being on the planning board, like Vinny was just saying, you know, we're having sidewalks in every, trying to get sidewalks in every development. The thing is, we as a planning board, at least now, are getting one side of every development to put in, and we're getting money back. But the thing that's happening now is COVID has opened up the eyes, I think, of a lot of people, because people now are walking more and more than they ever have before. I notice our streets have a lot more people walking. You know, I was doing a job the other day on Chandler Street. I was amazed at how many people walked by that house where I was working. And the thing is, you didn't see this before, or you didn't pay that much attention to it. I live on Shawshin Street. The sidewalk that goes from the Heathbrook School down to Main Street, there's people on that sidewalk all day long with their kids, with everything. And I'm a firm believer that the sidewalks have to take you somewhere. But right now, sidewalks are just like exercise or whatever it is for the people that are walking. They're out, they're walking their children, they're walking themselves, and it's just more and more. And it is a safety issue. So that's what I believe in. The thing is, what we also have to take a look at with the sidewalks is, if we have broken pieces, like say if you're going down Pleasant Street and there's an opening of, say, 300 feet or whatever, I feel as though that the pieces for those sidewalks have to be complete. And that's what I would look at as well. I mean, you know, you can look at Tewksbury, the main streets, at least Shawshin Street is probably the biggest. But there are more streets than just Shawshin. North Street only goes up as far as the soccer field. Okay, then you got the rest of North Street that has nothing. So that's what I believe in. And I think, how do you get the money for it? Where do we get the money for it? The town taxes now are skyrocketing. There's a lot of things going on. You know, but I still feel as though sidewalks are the most important thing. So we'll have to go from there. We'll just have to get, how do you get more money out of a builder? You know, these are all questions that have to be asked. You know, our town, when we put sidewalks in, we pay a certain wage. a developer or a builder, if he puts sidewalks in, he's not paying the same price as what we have to pay to put them in. He pays a lot less because he doesn't have to pay that wage. And people have to understand that. So that's where I am with it. I want sidewalks more than probably anybody because I'm older now. You know, I might need in the middle of the street when I'm walking instead of, you know, doing things. But this is what I feel. And I feel as though that with the Board of Selectmen, with the help of the town employees, that we can make, like, these builders, they have to know when they walk in to a development, before the plan even hits, that these sidewalks have to be there. And we have to make it so. And that's what I feel from all of us. Thank you very much, and let me speak.
Good stuff, Mr. Delaney. Good stuff. You say, how do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. One bite at a time. And we've made significant progress over the last couple of years with the sidewalk. So how about Ms. Wellman?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just had a couple of questions for Kevin. To Mr. Delaney's point about developers, when they build sidewalks as part of their project, is there any requirement for them to pay the prevailing wage on the sidewalk portion of their project, or is that all considered private, even though it's a public sidewalk they're building?
That would be no prevailing wage requirement for that.
Okay. And then my next question is, can you tell us a little bit about your development cycle for sidewalk design to build? Like, what's the... You're now working on the Shawshin Street portion now that's been approved by town meeting, and then you're going to work on the Whipple Street portion. What's your process for design to build?
So the way we have it outlined right now, we design in one fiscal year and construct in the following fiscal year. Once we get to the Whipple Road portion, because it's so long, but because there's an economy in doing the design all at once, we'll have the whole section designed, but then depending on funding, we may have to break that into phases.
Yep.
And at that point, we design that in one fiscal year, construct it over two fiscal years. But in that first fiscal year of construction, we'd be designing the next project to follow after the Whipple Road construction was completed.
Okay. I was looking at the plan that you that was sent around earlier today, which echoes the plans that's online right now. I don't know if that piece is online yet. But I noticed that Fisk Street has a project going in and that North Street was on the fifth year of that project. And so can you just give us a little insight as to the staging of those projects? And I think that the Fisk Street portion was a block grant. I'm not sure what the funding was there. Trying to understand a little bit more about that, how you tiered.
So we've applied for a complete streets grant for Fisk Street. And with the complete streets grants, you know, there are some requirements that you have to meet. And every project is scored based on really how many boxes they can check. Fisk Street connects to Andover Street, which you have the schools, you know, the Doing School is up there. Additionally, Andover Street 133 is a bus route for LRTA. So there's a transit portion part of that. And then because the north end of Fisk Street goes into Andover and there's senior housing within a quarter mile of the proposed sidewalk, that's another box that we check. So we put in Fisk Street knowing that there are some network gaps between Bailey and Andover. And that gets people down to, you know, the schools, you know, from those neighborhoods. But also that, you know, we can check a lot of boxes with that project. That's why we pursued Fisk Street for the complete streets grant, which we're eligible for.
That's great. So it's really important for the public to also hear that you guys are aggressively pursuing grant funding to supplement the local funding that we're looking to do as well. The only other comment I had, other than I think it's great the work that you're doing, and it's really good to see it and have us all get together and talk about how we are developing sidewalks. It's great to hear so much support for sidewalks. I'm wondering if there's any appetite for us to explore, perhaps with council, the development of a revolving fund for sidewalk funds and to come up with a funding mechanism as sort of a, sort of like MSBA puts a portion of the sales tax into school building funding. And I'm just wondering if there's any appetite among these boards to look at how we can do a revolving fund and actually fund our sidewalks a little bit more aggressively without being, you know, taking away too much from the rest of the way that we fund our budget, and do it really intentionally, especially where we have difficult budget seasons coming ahead. If we're intentional about what we're doing, we can put that money away, as well as pursuing legislative options such as, you know, CPC funding for new sidewalk construction. So some of those things, I think we need to look, you know, aggressively, but also intentionally. And I've just put that out there to the attendees. And thank you again.
Thank you, Ms. Bowman. Anyone else? Mr. Kratman? I think Mr. Kratman has a few more points.
I'd like to speak, Ms. Stronach,
please. The floor
is
yours.
Thank you so much. I appreciate that. I've been intently listening to this conversation. It is great to hear that sidewalks have finally taken center stage, as many of the planning board members have been working on this for many, many years. I want to kind of just comment on Selectman Wellman's comments about the revolving fund. I just want to make it clear from my perspective, I believe that this board and even the planning board maybe can be more intentional about the funding, but I believe that putting the $250,000, and that has only been in the last, I would refer to Mr. Montori, but I would say 3 years maybe, that we have been able to actually set aside that money and then compound that with additional Chapter 90 money to do this. So I do think it has been intentional. I am not sure where we would get the revolving fund unless you were looking to have the planning board do have builders put money into that. But as this has been discussed, it would be better to just ask the builders to build the sidewalks while they're working on the project, because the cost to them would be lower because of prevailing wage. So, you know, I don't know where Mr. Montori stands on the another revolving fund, but I'm always leery of, you know, getting new revolving funds, I want to be careful about that. And I also want to know, if we were to do something like that, where would the funds be, you know, coming from to fill that revolving fund? I do think putting aside the $250,000 every year is significant compared to what we had been doing previously. And to the point of the next few fiscal years, given the pandemic and what the losses in revenues, I get a little bit nervous because not that I don't think sidewalks are essential. I absolutely do. But as I think it was Mr. Delaney pointed out, they're expensive, and where does the money come from? So I just want to throw that out as food for thought. And I want to say I am glad that sidewalks are taking center stage. So thank you, and thank everybody for their comments tonight.
All right, Mr. Kratman, do you have a few more points, and then we'll we're close to the end here.
Okay, yeah, I just want to wrap it up. A couple of comments that came up, Mr. Fatalia, Mr. Johnson brought up a number of them about the locations of sidewalks, and Kevin spoke to it to some point, but one of the things that we have to also take into consideration is the stormwater. The town has graciously given us money to do stormwater improvements, and I think, you know, if you're a resident and you're driving up and down the road and you're wondering why there isn't sidewalks in a certain location, well, if you put a sidewalk in a certain location, that can become a dam. If you put a sidewalk in a place where the water usually flows off that roadway and goes into the wetland, and you install a new sidewalk, well, there's no place for that water to go if there's no drainage system out there. And so now I think Kevin is going to take that into consideration when we're doing this, work with our DPW. So as we're now putting in drainage improvements, that'll give us better availability to put sidewalks in. Because now, instead of having the water just puddle up in the middle of the roadway and have flooding and causing additional problems and maybe deteriorating that road quicker, we can do improvements. And I was thinking about specifically the other end of Livingston Street. If we were to put too many sidewalks along that area where the fields are, I think that area would flood quite a bit. Because it would just, when you're going down, without some sort of drainage improvements that goes down there, because you got slopes in different angles. I know when they put the concrete that's up there, and they did that intersection over, the state did that over, well, they put drainage improvements in there as part of that intersection improvement. So if you take a look at what they're doing at Salem and South right now, right now, you'll drive up there and you'll see all the drainage that they're putting in there. They're building detention basins, and they're digging by where the fireman statue is, so that when they're putting in those brand new sidewalks, there's going to be drainage improvements there, so the water will not pond up at the intersections. It's now going to drain off into a new catch basin and come off the roadway. Anybody who's seen a major flooding that used to happen out at where Market Basket is, down by the Maselli Bridge, that area, every time we used to have storms, that thing was underwater. Well, the town did incredible work rebuilding that section of roadway and did some unbelievable drainage improvements. And that's now we can do the sidewalks. So I think it's all planning. Like I said, I think we can do a better job communicating why things are done, but I have every confidence and Kevin and his team that they're designing and they're putting those things forward. I think we just have a better, we need to communicate better to say, this is why, these are the improvements that need to be done prior to putting those sidewalks in. And I think the drainage improvements will make it a lot easier as we install them. I'm in favor of granite curbing also. I think if you've got plows going up, they're going to tear up them if you put it down there. But the whole thing is, you know, you don't want to put a curbing or a berm if it's going to turn that roadway into a lake, because you need some drainage out there. But with the drainage improvements that we now have coming forward, that's going to help. So it's all planning, it's all open conversation, and that's where we're at. So I just wanted to bring that up and thank the residents, because I think that's going to be a big help as we're moving forward, as we're resurfacing roads that used to flood before. And as we're putting sidewalks in, that's all part of the puzzle. So I just wanted to add that to it.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Craven. All right. Before I put a vote, any additional last comments? Anyone from the board?
Jay?
Please.
I think there's someone on the line that wants to speak.
Well, this isn't, Mr. Fowler, this is not a public hearing. So no, the next time we'll let them speak.
All right.
So the next time we'll let them speak, and that I had a lot of residents, they asked, I said, listen, we're just getting together as a board. We're going to talk about these two items. So the next time either, you know, you all meet or we all meet, we'll absolutely have public comments, you know. And I'll say this, because it's just we had the Open Space Committee come in front of us. I know they came in front of you last evening. Very good presentation. So we have to think really big, not only just our boards, but even, you know, what committees can help us when we have some decision making or some thought process around sidewalks. So case some point, but for the next time we will absolutely open up to the public. That's all.
I understand all that, right. Jay, and it was Brian, someone was trying to get Brian Dorrington to allow Chris Mullins to speak, and I know the fact that this is not a public hearing, so.
Well, I got a few residents that pinged me, so I said the next time you can come to a selectman meeting and feedback is welcome. That's why we're having the conversations. You know what I mean? We're talking about them. We're executing. You know, we all want to run faster, but sometimes you know we're absolute focus is on sidewalks. That's why we're having a conversation collectively. So,
Good.
All right. Anything else from any other board member? All right. Seeing none. Well, I can't thank you guys enough. This was very good. We definitely have to do it more often. I know we had a lot of conversations. So just to wrap it up, we're going to do some homework on the Pleasant Street intersection. We still have a lot of questions or concerns that we want to get addressed. And we also, as far as the sidewalks here, seems like we're on the same page. Let's stay connected, and we'll just go from there. With that being said, I will look for a motion to adjourn. And since it's a selectman meeting, Bob, I know this is crazy, but we have to do the roll call vote. So I'll just ask the selectman for a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
Okay, roll call vote. Ms. Wellman?
Aye.
Ms. Stronach?
Aye.
Mr. Kratman?
Aye.
Chair votes aye as well. Thank you very much. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bob, I would adjourn the planning board meeting also.
Well, I didn't know this, did it. I didn't know if we were invited or if we were part of the meeting. So
it's a posted meeting, so I would definitely.
I have a motion to adjourn the meeting for the planning board. Who's speaking?
So moved.
All right, do we have a second?
Second.
On the motion, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the ayes have it. Mr. Ryder.
Good night.
Mr. Ryder?
Aye.
Aye.
Yeah, thanks.
Mr. Johnson.
Thanks, Jimmy.
Mr. Fratalia.
I don't think Vinny's on.
I think he dropped off.
I'll vote aye.
Okay. All right.
Okay.
The chair votes aye. That's three. That's enough.
Thank you, guys. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.